In addition to Surah al-Fajr tonight, we will look at several verses which are in sequential order from Surah al-Shu'ara, chapter number 26 of the Holy Quran, and therefore those brothers and sisters who have Quran with them, it will be very useful to have that in front of them, inshallah. We will see a debate between Fir'aun and Musa alayhi salam, and how that comes about in the example of the debate between Yazid and our fourth Imam Zain al-Abidin, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. قل المؤمنين والمؤمنات ثواب الفاتحة. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين خاتم النبيين سيدنا الممجد بشير المصدق المصطفى الأمجد محمود الأحمد أبي القاسم محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين ولعن الله ولا الظالمين من الأولين والآخرين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والفجر وليال عشر والشفع والوتر والليل إذا يسر هل في ذلك قسم لذي حجر ألم تر كيف فعل ربك بعاد إرم ذات العماد التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد وثمود الذين جابوا الصخر بالواد وفرعون ذي الأوتاد الذين طغوا في البلاد فأكثروا فيها الفساد فصب عليهم ربك سوط عذاب إن ربك لبالمرصاد فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه ربه فأكرمه ونعمه فيقول ربي أكرمن وأما إذا ما ابتلاه فقدر عليه رزقه فيقول ربي أهانن كلا بل لا تكرمون اليتيم ولا تحاضون على طعام المسكين وتأكلون التراث أكلا لما وتحبون المال حبا جما كلا إذا دكت الأرض دكا دكا وجاء ربك والملك صفا صفا وجيء يومئذ بجهنم يومئذ يتذكر الإنسان وأنى له الذكرى يقول يا ليتني قدمت لحياتي فيومئذ لا يعذب عذابه أحد ولا يوثق وثاقه أحد يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية فادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي صلوات Master of our age, Imam Zamana, my respected elders, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Our discussions in these last couple of days have led us to understand that the three tyrannical leaders and rulerships, civilizations that are presented within Surah Al-Fajr, are there for us to understand the methodology, the outlook, the actions of the greatest tyrants within history, particularly Yazid bin Muawiyah and his father Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan. And we find that when it comes to Ad, the first point was that they set a precedent for thought process, an outlook. In specific, they had an attitude whereby they felt that none could touch them. They felt that they were the most superior of all superiors. And hence, one of the verses of Quran specifies that they ask, is anyone more powerful than us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds by saying, surely the one who has created you is more powerful than you in the first place. And then it comes to the group of Thamud. Yesterday we discussed Thamud, And we highlighted that their particular aspect was, number one, that they inherited this ideology from Ad rather than learning from the mistakes of Ad. And we find that they were the ones who migrated away from the area of Yemen geographically towards the area of Medina, towards Syria, on the basis that they actually felt that they could migrate away from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Ad are the community that built left very lofty palaces, very high towers, then we are the ones who are going to build our houses within the actual caves and mountains on the basis that maybe the punishment will not overtake us there. But of course, they too were not only the ones who had a bad attitude, but they progressed in their own denial of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by taking it a step further and having the audacity to even kill a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find that this yesterday was an easy comparison towards the martyrdom of the master of the martyrs, Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullah wa salamuhu alayhi. Our discussion tonight, therefore, leads us to the third tyrannical group and individual that is mentioned within these verses of Quran, and that is Fir'aun. Fir'aun is not somebody who is alien to us, and in fact, within the Holy Quran, the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun is the single most foretold story within the Quran. It is the single story that is mentioned the most within the Quran. And you find that's actually quite interesting in the fact that one would probably assume that maybe it would be the specifics of the Holy Prophet of Islam, his name, his history would be the one that is mentioned the most within the Holy Quran. In fact, it is Musa alayhi salam that is named the most. And you find his name and his story is mentioned in more than 30 different chapters of the Holy Quran. And therefore, proportionately, out of the 114, one can see how much emphasis Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed upon the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun. According to the scholars, there are five main reasons as to why the story of Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun and Banu Israel is mentioned. These five provide us with a categorization for our backdrop and understanding of the story. And therefore, whenever we observe the story of Musa alayhi salam in any capacity, we should straight away try to resolve the story, our knowledge, the lessons therein, back to one of these five principal reasons. Number one, the reason being because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wished to present this story to the Muslims who were converting to Islam and show them that the same way Banu Israel were tortured, you are also being tortured. But have faith and remember, the same way that we freed Banu Israel and blessed upon them so many ni'mat, we too promise you victory and you will also get these very same ni'mat. Number one, it was a means of solace for the Muslim community. Number two, the second reason is because therein, the story of Musa alayhi salam, he as an individual, as a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was deserved of such mention that he should be encapsulated within the confines of the Holy Quran. Now that point is very important for us to ponder upon as individuals, in that history continues to be written every single day. We are in fact writing our own history at the moment with every breath that we take. The beauty is Islam shows us that by virtue of our own struggle, by virtue of our own spirituality, there are times in history where you and I, our achievements, our successes, either as an individual or as a community, can be heralded in the history of Islam itself. The same way Musa alayhi salam was in the Quran. Show you an example. We find that Hadith al-Qisa, all of us are accustomed and know the value and the depth of Hadith al-Qisa. Hadith al-Qisa is that wonderful series of events that take place when the verse of Tathir is delivered to us to see the wonderful creation of Ahlulbayt. What a wonderful tradition we have, and we constantly recite it. How often do we recite this hadith? Every time there is a kushali, we recite this hadith. When we have family members that are getting married, we recite this hadith al-Qisa. We try to commence all of our gatherings, even if it be a localized gathering in our house with Hadith al-Qisa. Look at the value of Hadith al-Qisa in a historical context. How much we have learned from this tradition. What does it begin with? What are the opening words of Hadith al-Qisa? An Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. Then it comes to An Fatima al-Zahra salamullahi alayha. What are we being told here? Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa alayhi. What are we being told here? By that one moment of struggle, one moment of brilliance in discussion between the Lady of Light and this grand companion Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, until the end of time we constantly narrate his name. Or take another example. Yesterday was Thursday night. We recited which dua? Dua of Khidr, right? Dua of Khidr. But we don't name it Dua of Khidr. We name it Dua Kumail. You see that historical situation that took place. The commander of the faithful says his most famous of words. He says, I'm going to recite a dua tonight, and you should recite it every Thursday night. If you cannot, then you should recite it once a month, if not once a year, if not at least once in your lifetime. There were a number of companions who were sitting beside the commander of the faithful when that statement was made. Which one of the companions rose and said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, teach us this dua? None. Kumail follows the commander of the faithful back to his house. The commander of the faithful turns when he's standing at the door. O Kumail, what is it that you want? O Amir al-Mu'mineen, you told us of this wonderful dua, but we have not heard it yet from you. And at that point, he now begins to tell him what the dua is. We as a community have inherited this noble dua, and we have decided consciously and subconsciously to change the name of the dua from Dua Khidr, a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not an ordinary prophet, a prophet who is mentioned in Quran, a prophet who teaches Prophet Musa alayhi salam, a prophet of Allah that is going to be there for you and I when we get lost on travel. But still, we choose to name this dua after a companion of the commander of the faithful, by virtue of his struggle that becomes everlasting. The same way, Musa alayhi salam's name is mentioned within Quran because of his own struggle that he achieved in his lifetime. The problems Banu Israel gave to him and the accomplishments that he was worthy of. Number two. Number three is that there are, of course, many lessons to be derived as a human body from the story of Banu Israel, Musa and Fir'aun. Number four, it is a point of discussion, especially as an interfaith dialogue. How many friends do we have that may be Christian? How many friends do we have that are from the Jewish faith? We sit with them every day at school, every day at work. The question can be posed for myself is, how many times did I, during my time in school, how many times did I, during my day in work, at the times when we went to lunch and went to dinner, discuss Musa alayhi salam? Not for the point of trying to convert my friends, but rather for the purpose of spreading knowledge in itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides whom He wills. If He wishes to send light in the heart of a person, that person will see more light than I ever could. But maybe, just maybe, by my discussion with Musa alayhi salam, with my Jewish friend, I will have the opportunity of discussing the Quran and more other beautiful issues of this religion. And the fifth reason why the Prophet Musa alayhi salam's story is mentioned within the Quran is because you and I, as an ummah, have followed the issues of Banu Israel, and we are being warned not to follow the precedents and the examples set by Banu Israel. As an example, within the opening verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, there is a statement, a hadith, a verse of Quran that is mentioned. People of Banu Israel changed their book and mixed up falsehood with truth whilst they knew it. The warning was for you and I as a Muslim ummah, that even though you have the Quran, do not mix up the truth with falsehood. Do not change the verses of Quran. And unfortunately, Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan did this himself when he was willing to pay 400,000 dirham to a person to lie that one verse of Quran was about Ibn Muljim as opposed to the commander of the faithful. Do not mix up the truth with falsehood whilst you know it. What a hideous, action. In fact, a hadith comes to us, and this is narrated primarily within the books of our brothers, the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, where it says to us, Rasulullah has a hadith, he tells us, my ummah, after my death, will follow the way of the Christians and the Jews, shibrin bi shibrin. Shibrin bi shibrin in Arabic is translated as step by step. Everything that the Jews and the Christians did, my ummah will follow them, shibrin bi shibrin. To the extent, this is the hadith, not my words, to the extent that if a lizard was to go into a hole, they would follow that lizard exactly as the Jews and the Christians changed their religion. The Muslims will change their religion in the same way. Therefore, five reasons as to why the story of Musa, Banu Israel, and Fir'aun is there for you and I to take into our 21st century life. And therefore, when we come to look at this verse within Surah Al-Fajr, it says, وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِي الْأَوْتَادِ. Fir'aun, the lord of the pegs. Now this awtad is translated into a number of ways. So we need to understand what it means by this awtad so that we can firstly take a precedent as to the outlook of Fir'aun, therefore also understand the outlook of Yazid, and then move into the specificity of what Fir'aun and Yazid would have done in their times. When we look at this verse, وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِي الْأَوْتَادِ. Awtad has a number of meanings from the Arabic to the English. We use this word quite often. We have the word watad. We find that this word awtad can be translated as a tent peg. It can be translated as a column. But either way, it is there to denote something which is very strong, very sturdy, something that holds down something. The hadith from our 60 Imam, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, where he says about certain companions of his, he names four companions of his, great companions, and he says these companions are the awtad of the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are like the tent pegs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's religion. Meaning what? That a tent peg is there for the purpose of securing that into the ground, so that no matter what gust of wind comes, it cannot be blown away. Meaning that these great companions are that emblem of Islam, to the extent that with their presence, with their knowledge, no gust of wind from any enemy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can blow away the true religion of Ahlul Bayt. Again, one shows what heights us as individuals can reach when we put our heart and soul into the realm of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, dhil awtad, that he is the lord of the spikes, lord of the pegs. Awtad is also given another translation in that it is the lord of the pyramids, meaning that literally those pyramids that we see within the great cities in Egypt, that those were the pyramids that even Fir'aun used to rule over. And we came to this point yesterday when we spoke about the technologies that man has and will accomplish. And we find here that just the way these descriptions of Ad and Thamud are being given to us, even the technological advancements of Fir'aun is being mentioned here, that he was the lord of these great pyramids. Until today, those who know and research about Egyptian history will tell you that they still find difficulty in understanding how the Egyptians moved those great blocks from one area to another and lifted them so high in the sky to be able to make them into the blocks of pyramids that they are today. Fir'aun was the lord of all of these things. Imagine what level of arrogance this man had. And one can only begin to imagine the level of arrogance Yazid bin Muawiyah had himself. And therefore, when it comes to this technology, it doesn't stop here. As a point in passing, when it came to Fir'aun, his own attitude was because he had dominion and rulership over the river Nile, and other countries within the region did not have that luxury, did not have that accessibility, did not have that constant means for agricultural development. He felt in possession of all of these things, as lord of all of these things. Even the Egyptians were very forward-thinking in their chemistry, weren't they? They had ability to mummify and keep hold what the body was until today. We still see their technological advancements. Fir'aun, dhil awtad, he was the lord of all of these accomplishments, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. We find that even when it came to his outlook of this, his arrogance had reached such a level that we find in that famous verse of Quran where he says, build me a lofty tower so I may ascend towards the very heights of the heavens, so I may challenge the Lord of Musa. Why? For I find him lying about his God. We don't just think it in terms of his arrogance. We also see this in terms of his technological capability. He actually felt his servants and slaves could build him a tower so high that he was able to actually reach those heights. It's not just one-sided. He felt the capability of technology was under his very palms. I will ascend to the heights to be able to challenge the Lord of Musa alayhi salam. This is the outlook of Fir'aun. This is his example. And then we now go into specific verses of his actions. And when we see the specific verses of actions, we then be able to link between Fir'aun and the Fir'aun at the time of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, salawatullahu wasalamu alayhi. In Baqarah, Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spends 100 verses speaking of Banu Israel. You can imagine as a reader of the Holy Quran for the first time, or as a non-Muslim, when we hand out the Quran to them at our places of work and education, and we say, we encourage them, read this Quran. Know for yourself what it says, and not what just Pastor X, Y, and Z thinks it says. Read for yourself. And when they read, of course, one will probably look through the contents page, and straight away they will be probably introduced to something new. The chapter of Noah, the chapter of Mary, the chapter of Joseph. I had no realization of this in the first place. But then they will probably, logic says, open the verses in chronological order. Where would you start? Surah Al-Fatiha. And then you get to Surah Al-Baqarah. Within the opening verses, we have, of course, the verses in regards to belief and kufr and being a munafiq. And then it moves towards the story of Adam alayhi salam. Very apt place to start. The very next discussion in Quran is the story of Banu Israel. It comes to a point in the early verses, just before verses 50, so verses 48, 49, it now begins to name and mention Fir'aun. It mentions something very interesting. It says, and remember Pharaoh. And remember Pharaoh and the tortures that he performed upon you. What tortures? That he used to kill your sons and free your women. He would kill the men and free the women. This is specifically mentioned within Quran at the opening of the discussion of the release of slavery for Banu Israel from Fir'aun. Why is this mentioned in this term, in this way? As we have 70,000 layers of this verse, what is being mentioned here at face value and what is being mentioned therein? At face value, as we know it, refers to how Fir'aun wanted to kill each newborn son. Eventually, he wanted to kill them once every year, and the second year he would leave them, and the next year he would kill, and the next year he would, and so on and so forth. And the idea, of course, was he had heard and knew from his own soothsayers that there would be a man who would rise from amongst them in order to free Banu Israel from his evil clutches. Therefore, the idea was to kill that Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to ensure that he does not come into existence. What happened in history was that the women and the men stopped approaching each other. They stopped approaching each other out of fear that they would conceive a child, and therefore that would be the child that would eventually be killed. One of the Prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Shu'aib alayhi salam, who ends up being the father-in-law of Musa alayhi salam, has a hadith where he says, come what may, no matter even if none of you approach each other, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ensure that that savior comes into existence. And therefore we are illuminated in our heart that no matter what happens, no matter what grief and difficulty we go through, the awaited Savior of our time will indeed come, inshallah, soon. And so, at this point, the verse says, at a very apparent level, that this was based upon the killing. We used to kill your sons, the males, and we would free your women. And therefore, of course, there is an evident and very clear analysis towards the Fir'aun of the time of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn. Because on the 10th of Muharram, very evidently, it was the sons and the males generally that were being killed and slaughtered. And it was the women that would be left alive. That doesn't necessarily mean that their torture was any less. What it means was that there was a physical torture blown towards the male side. But the women would have gone through a deep emotional torture. And this was the torture that Fir'aun would have put upon the women and children of their time, and what the Fir'aun of Aba Abdullah performed towards the people on the 10th of Muharram. We will devastate Farwa. We will devastate Layla. We will devastate all of these great ladies by our attacking of the men and of the children. All your sons will be slaughtered. But at a deeper level, as you go further in, we find that this is a pharaonic system in play. Now, this term is very, very important. Only a few of the scholars have discussed and described this idea. There is a pharaonic system in play here. The idea that is, we will subjugate you. It is not just only our killing of the males and the freeing of the women to allow you to live, but thereby tormenting you emotionally. It is an entire system of how we subjugate you, as how we as Fir'aun, as pharaohs, leaders, dastardly leaders will subjugate you at all times. This idea is about how we will manifest our authority and power over you. There's once a story, a hadith, a wonderful hadith that comes from Bahlul. Now Bahlul, we all know, he would act insane or act crazy in order to send his beautiful point across. So we know the Caliph al-Rashid that was alive at his time, it one day said that Bahlul entered into the palace of al-Rashid. As he entered into the palace, he went into the royal domain and found the throne of al-Rashid. He went and he looked around and saw it was quiet. There was no one in that room. That room was empty. So he goes and he ascends the throne of the Caliph. And he sits there and he makes gestures as if he is the king and he is giving out orders and you must go there and bring me this thing. And at this point, having played, enacted the Caliph, servants, guards, soldiers of the Caliph enter into the room at that point in time. You can imagine their reaction, not seeing their king on the throne, but seeing the man who is always amusing and taking the mickey out of this very king, sitting on the throne, also laughing and joking about him. What do you think the guards' reaction was going to be? They take Bahlul, they throw him towards the floor. They begin to beat him and strike him and beat him till he's bleeding and pulverized. He is crying out and weeping and crying. The commotion that is causes the Fir'aun of that time, al-Rashid, to enter into that room. What is going on? What is going on? Why am I hearing such crying and why am I hearing such shouting? At this point, he sees that it's Bahlul being pulverized. He separates them. He says, stop. This is Bahlul. What have you done? We found him. He was sitting on your throne, O Caliph, and he was mocking you and he was giving orders to people who are not there. We dragged him down and we beat him for the crime that he performed. At this point, Fir'aun takes him and he begins to sit with him and he says to him, Bahlul, it's okay. There is no need to cry anymore. They have stopped beating you. He says, you do not understand, O Caliph. I am not crying because of the pain that was inflicted upon me by your soldiers. I am crying out of sorrow for you. What do you mean? Why are you crying for me? You're the one being beaten to the point in which you are bloodied. Why are you crying for me? I cry for you, O king, because I sat illegally on the throne of the king for only a few minutes and this is how I was treated. You have been sitting illegally on the throne in the pulpit of Ahlul Bayt all your life. Can you imagine the punishment that is awaiting you in the next world? Can you imagine? I don't know what reaction the Caliph would have had to that. But the pharaohs have a distinct methodology in which when they subjugate, they are killing and they are performing emotional torture. This is why, as you go deeper into this verse, one of the great scholars, we've mentioned him before at one of the opening nights, Ayatollah Sayyid Muhammad Taqi Mudarrisi, may Allah bless his soul with long life, you find Ayatollah Mudarrisi talks about a pharaonic system. And you can find here, a pharaonic system is when the king, the leadership, want to subjugate you, but in any number of methods. How? They will subjugate you by taking you out of your culture and making you adopt their own culture. They will subjugate you by taking you out of your own food and making you eat their food. They will subjugate you by making you believe their media system so that what they tell you is what you end up believing. They will subjugate you by making you think like them, act like them, talk like them. And the idea is to move you from what you are rather than being governed by the system of Allah, Ahlul Bayt in Quran, to subjugate one under their own pharaonic system to the point where you forget your own as to who you really are. This happened over a number of decades towards Banu Israel. We do not have time to go into that as a depthful analysis, but I will show you that when you look into the verses after they have been freed, they still remember the system of Pharaoh that has subjugated them. They had desired the system of Pharaoh that has subjugated them to the point where even when they are blessed with divine food from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they say what? We do not want this same food. Give us new food. Go back towards the lentils and towards the garlics and the onions and the herbs that we desire. We don't even want the food of God. We'd rather have the food that is given to us by the pharaonic system. You see here, the pharaonic system is there to subjugate the mind and the soul. And the idea is to take you away from that and bring you to this. Every pharaoh, be it the pharaoh of Musa, be it the pharaoh at the time of Ahlul Bayt, be it the pharaoh at the time of Hussein ibn Ali, Imam Ridha, or the pharaoh that is living until today, the pharaoh that is sitting there on his throne within Bahrain, the pharaoh that is sitting there in the throne of X, Y, and Z, those same pharaohs of today, they are performing that same subjugation that is mentioned within Quran. We will kill your sons and we will spare your women to cry and weep, to the point where if we kill your sons, you cannot longer reproduce and you will be forced to be with us and none of your own. To the extent that today, young Palestinians, they throw stones at helicopter gunships. We will kill your sons and we will spare your women. Every pharaonic system can be found within that one verse of Fir'aun at that time. The idea is subjugation of all levels. I'm sure you understand what I'm trying to say. And therefore, one now needs to go further into the aspects of Fir'aun himself in Quran and see how even other sides of that Fir'aun within Quran are mirrored by Yazid bin Muawiyah. We have mentioned a very simple example in that Yazid on the 10th of Muharram killed the men and spared the women to subjugate them, thinking he had control over them. But now we must turn back towards the Holy Quran and look further. And there is a unique series of verses within Surah Al-Shu'ara, which is chapter number 26 of the Holy Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala presents possibly the most interesting evidence of how Fir'aun was and how the movement of Karbala, not just confined to the 10 nights of Muharram, but even to the time of Arba'een can be seen within the Holy Quran. Let us turn firstly to verse number 10 of Surah Al-Shu'ara, chapter number 26, verse number 10. We'll allow our brothers and sisters who are going towards their Quran and phones, inshallah. One loud salah ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and when your Lord called out to Musa saying, go towards the unjust people. The people of Fir'aun, will they not guard against evil? Musa responds, O my Lord, surely I fear that they shall reject me. Straighten my heart, and my tongue is not eloquent, therefore send to me Harun as an aid. They have a crime against me, therefore I fear that they shall slay me. Here verse 15 presents us with such a wonderful insight to the reality that is this issue. Verse 15 says, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, قَالَ كَلَّا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds by saying, no way, no chance, by no means. فَأَذْهَبَا بِآيَتِنَا إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, go, both of you, with our signs. Surely we are with you, hearing. إِنَّا مَعَكُمْ مُسْتَمِعُونَ From the word, as-sami'. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-sami' and al-basir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is given two asma within Quran of this nature. He is called the all-hearing and he is called the all-seeing. We are very comfortable with these terms, as-sami'u and al-basiru. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is entitled these two titles. When it comes to al-basiru, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of course sees everything that we do. The question I pose is, in this verse of Quran, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa alayhi salam that we are listening to you, go with you, both of you, with our signs, we are surely listening to you, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala choose to mention only the term listening and not both of them? Why does he not say we are watching and hearing? Is he not as-sami'u and basiru? Do we not have this term normally that is molded together? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say only I am listening to you? We find we have to go back into the philosophy of what's being told to us here. There are three support mechanisms that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives towards Musa alayhi salam. The first is physical, the second is supernatural, and the third is confidence in himself. The first is physical. How does he give him physical aid? He gives him Harun alayhi salam. I'm going to give you someone with you. You know, when you go to somewhere, it is often, especially if you're going to be challenged and you have someone with you, a partner with you, you feel less burdened. You feel that you can work together. There is a partner with me who can aid me in what I'm trying to achieve. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Musa alayhi salam physical aid. Then he gave to him supernatural aid. What does he give to him? Ayatina. He gives to him blessed signs. He has a cane that can turn into a snake and gobble up another. He has the capability of shining nur from his hand. These are supernatural aids that Musa alayhi salam is given. But the third and possibly the most important aid that Musa alayhi salam was given is self-confidence. The means and the ability to stand before Fir'aun and say, I am Musa, free the people of Banu Israel. Do not enslave the people of Banu Israel. Can you imagine now, even if you have these two aids, even if you have your brother, and even if you have a supernatural aid, what use is it if you have not been given the self-confidence to go and stand in front of the Fir'aun of your time? And it's the same way. We find Sayyidah Zainab salamullahi alayha and Imam Zainul Abideen salawatullahu salamu alayhi. They had each other. They had each other. Musa had Harun, whilst Zainab had Imam Zainul Abideen. Zainul Abideen had Sayyidah Zainab. Can you imagine the confidence it must have given to stand with that great personality next to you, knowing that in years to come, when they spoke about that great sermon, they would say, we thought Ali ibn Abi Talib was speaking upon that day. Can you imagine that day when he, Zainul Abideen, is able to stand and say, we are given 6 and we are given 7. None other have been given this within history. the confidence it gave to stand. And then they were even given supernatural means to prove, were they not? Does the head of Hussein alayhi salam not recite verses of Quran? In fact, even our Sunni brethren believe in this within their history. It is known that the head of Hussein spoke the verses of Surah Al-Kahf. And then they were given that confidence within themselves to stand in front of that Fir'aun, knowing Allah is listening to them. Why not just say we are watching? Because we know Allah is watching. But He is listening to everything within here as well. He recognizes the absolute belief that you have within the depth of your heart. Meaning for you and I in the 21st century, that whenever we face our own Fir'aun, whenever we see the enemies of God standing upon us, that we are still able to have the confidence that we can make a change. We will walk, we will rise, we will write an email, we will make videos, whatever we can do in our own way, we will, because God is listening to what our intention is within our heart. He is not just watching us, yes, wherever I go, but He knows in depth the intention. And as we find that even with that Fir'aun at the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam, that frog sees the opportunity to put just one spout of water upon the fire. When asked and ridiculed, why did you do this? I did it because I said that I could stand in front of my Lord and say to Him, I did my bit. Whichever Fir'aun is there in front of me, I can stand and say, I did my bit. Can you imagine now, when it comes to this point in Quran where they go to reach their own Fir'aun? The idea here is freedom. We go to verse number 16. Then come to Fir'aun, and this is beautiful. This sentence, this verse, has so much within it. It is unbelievable. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Musa, go to Fir'aun and say the following. The following words are, فَقُولَا إِنَّ رَسُولَ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. Go to Fir'aun and say, surely we are messengers of the Lord of the worlds. Send with us, Banu Israel. Now, any child will tell you, what is the first issue of Islam? Is it Nabuwat? No. What's your first form of your Usuluddin? Tawheed. Oneness. Go back to the verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa alayhi salam to present Islam. He doesn't say to him, tell him of Tawheed. The first thing he says to him is, tell him that you are the messenger from Allah. He talks to him about Nabuwat before he talks to him about Tawheed. Why? Because Fir'aun was such a human being that he had already rejected Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had he not. He had said, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la. There was no wahdaniyah within him. There was no belief system in the one God that would be over his hand. Therefore, there was no point in coming to him and saying to him about Tawheed in the first place. The same way we find this rejection of God in Fir'aun. We find this same rejection of God in the Fir'aun at the time of Aba Abdullah. Did Yazid not say, Banu Hashim played with the kingdom. No news and no revelation came. I reject God and Islam altogether. The Fir'aun of Quran is the same as the Fir'aun at the time of Aba Abdullah. In fact, there is another hadith in which we find so openly, in which he rejects everything. Hadith tell us that as the captives were being brought to Damascus, we've all been, inshallah, to Damascus, may Allah take us again and again. As you enter into Bazar al-Sham, you know that you are walking and you have the bazaar on each side of you, you have the markets either side of you, and then you walk and then eventually you get to the palace of Fir'aun. Imagine now what took place. As they got towards the palace of Fir'aun, a narration says that Fir'aun was standing upon a ledge, watching the kafila being brought towards his palace. What words he recited? You know what words he recited? Now I have what I've wanted to take from Muhammad the Messenger. I now have what I wanted to take from him. I wanted to take the head of Hussein, his grandson, and I now have the head, Hussein, from the son. Can you imagine the level of rejection within the Fir'aun at the time of Aba Abdullah? And therefore the first statement can be seen by Musa alayhi salam. He didn't say Tawheed, he said Nabuwat, because rejection was within the heart of Fir'aun. And then we conclude with this point. Verse 18, Fir'aun and Musa begin to debate. This is truly wonderful series of verses to see a debate between a prophet of Allah and the enemy tyrant. Fir'aun said, did we not bring you up as a child? As we know, Musa alayhi salam was a child within the household of Pharaoh. Did we not bring you up as a child? Are you not grateful for what we did for you? The next verse, Musa alayhi salam responds in verse 22, is it a favor that you enslaved my community, Banu Israel? Check this verse, number 23, the next subsequent verse. Fir'aun says, and what is the Lord of the worlds? Hang on a minute. I thought you were talking about being enslaved. I thought you were talking about slavery. Why did Fir'aun go back towards the discussion about the Lord of the worlds? Look at the chronology. Look at the chronology of it. Musa alayhi salam is asked a question. Fir'aun says, did we not bring you up as a child within the house? Are you ungrateful for us having looked after you? Musa responds by saying, is it gratitude I should show you that you enslaved Banu Israel? Fir'aun responds and says, tell me, what is the Lord of the worlds? It doesn't flow, does it? It doesn't make sense. Why does it not make sense? Because Fir'aun was defeated by the argument of Musa alayhi salam. And rather than addressing the issue, he had to change the issue. When you are defeated as a Pharaoh, instead of answering, you know what, you are right, I have enslaved Banu Israel. You're right, it is not a blessing and a favor from me. Take them, you are right, because I have lost the debate. The loser of the debate, rather than accepting his loss of debate, changes the debate in order to argue another point. I will argue back with you in regards to your Lord, because I believe I am the Lord. The same thing happened. Exactly the same thing happened when the fourth Imam presented himself in front of Yazid. The heads of the Shuhada were placed upon a spear. They entered into the court of this dastardly human being, this most tyrannical of human being that has ever been created. And they begin to debate with each other, do they not? What happens, he says to him, did you find the command of Allah to be set upon you? Imam responds and says, this is indeed the command of Allah, but you have taken his life. Allah did not take this man's life. The debate continues between them. He begins to recite a verse of Quran. Imam says to him that indeed Allah, he says to him, a verse from Surah Al-Hadid, verses 21 to 23. He says to him, indeed all of this has been written in a book well before even your existence. At this point, even Yazid begins to debate with him and says to him, indeed, the oppressors, you see that the oppression that has been put upon you, that we have not done this. And then Zain al-Abidin continues to debate with him. When he loses the debate, what does Yazid respond with? He argues his way out of it and says, indeed, curse be upon Ibn Ziyad. Rather than accepting he was the one at fault, he says, curse be upon Ibn Ziyad, for he is the one that cut ties with you. He is the one that has done this to you. I am completely absolved of my own responsibility. This same debate that took place between Musa and Fir'aun takes place between Zain al-Abidin and the Fir'aun of that time. Musa alayhi salam demands the freedom of Banu Israel. Do you not see that freedom on the 10th of Muharram? Do you not see that same statement is made by Aba Abdullah on the 10th of Muharram? He says, if you do not have any belief in the hereafter, then at least be free human beings. The same thing that was faced within Fir'aun is faced within Yazid at that time as well. A man that is free is the one who in all trials and tribulations, he is the one that recognizes that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there for him at all times, and that no matter what comes before him, he is pleased with the destiny that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in front of him. Qasim ibn al-Hasan, he stands in that tent And when asked that question of death, how do you see death? What a free human being. At 13 years old, to say the words, I see death sweeter than honey. Before we go into the martyrdom of Qasim ibn al-Hassan, may Allah bless him, and Abdullah ibn Hassan, may Allah bless him, I want to take a line from our second imam and see how this became manifested in Aba Abdullah on the 10th of Muharram in regards to Qasim ibn al-Hassan. One of the greatest narrators of the tragedy of the Lady of Light was her own son, Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam. Imam al-Hassan, the young boy, and being the eldest of the children, he observed everything. He was present when the door fell. He was present when a Fir'aun attacked her. He was observant of everything that took place. There's a line of poetry that is said about him. It is attributed to him. Imagine this great lady. The door has been flung upon her. She has lost her child. Her chest internally is broken into a piece. And then she still goes to face the Fir'aun of her time. She then goes and stands and demands Fadak back for herself. Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam has a series of lines where he narrates. And he says that my mother, when we left the house, our house, to go towards the mosque, to meet that Fir'aun and demand what was rightfully ours, when she went to demand, she being my mother, took me with her towards that man. And she held my hand. You know when a mother takes the hand of her child and walks with her. He walks. And Lady Zahra walked with Imam Hassan. Imam Hassan says that when my mother took me towards that place, she was holding my hand, indicating a level of strength within her. But when she was denied Fadak, when that piece of paper was ripped up and thrown in her face, she felt so weak at that point that I had to hold her hand en route back towards the house. And at this point, when Imam Hassan alayhi salam begins to describe these issues, there is a zakir, and this is the link towards Aba Abdullah. When a zakir, it's narrated, recited the tragedy of Sayyidah Zahra and what Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam went through. The zakir narrates, he says, I recited that one day Imam Ali alayhi salam came home and found Imam al-Hassan sitting in the corner of the house weeping profusely, crying and crying. He comes towards his dear son and says, oh Imam al-Hassan, oh my young son, why are you crying like this? He looks up and with his tears flowing down his eyes, he says to his father, oh Amir al-Mu'mineen, oh my dear father, if you had seen what I had seen on that day, if you had seen what I had seen on that day, you too would be crying the way I am crying. And then the zakir says that that night he went to sleep, and in that night, Imam al-Hassan alayhi salam came to him in a dream. He came to him in a dream, and Imam al-Hassan says to him, O Zakir, O Alim, O Sheikh, thank you for reciting the tragedy of myself and my mother. But you did not recite the greatest tragedy that was befelling, that had befallen upon me. He says, but what happened, O dear Imam? I recited that the door fell upon your mother Fatima. He says, this is not the greatest tragedy to have befallen upon Imam al-Hassan. To see this was not the greatest tragedy. He said, what is the greatest tragedy to have ever befallen upon you? The fact that when I saw that door falling upon her, I was unable to do anything for my mother. The fact that I was unable to come to her aid. The fact that when I went there, the door had already fallen upon her. The fact that she had been calling out, Fiddah, come to my aid, come to my aid. At this point, Look at the words of Imam al-Hasan, that the greatest tragedy that was I was unable to come towards your aid. Come to the 10th of Muharram. And Hussein ibn Ali says the same words to Qasim. The greatest tragedy was that I was unable to come to your aid when you called me, O Qasim. It is narrated that Qasim ibn al-Hasan comes towards Aba Abdullah on the 10th of Muharram. He comes towards him and he says to him, "Oh my dear uncle, allow me to go out and defend you and the message of Rasulullah." He says to him, "Allow me to go out. I see you are all alone. Oh my dear uncle, allow me." Hussein ibn Ali responds and constantly tells him, "No, you are not allowed. I do not give you that permission." At this point, he goes back towards his dear mother and he says to his dear mother, "Please, is there anything that you can do? Hussein is not allowing me towards the battlefield." His mother, Farwa salamullahi alayha, says that there is a parchment, there is an edict from your father Hassan that says that he will not be there on the 10th of Muharram. Give this towards Hussein and he will not refuse you. Qasim takes this letter towards Hussein, and when Hussein begins to read it, his eyes fill with tears. "Oh Qasim, how can I say no when my brother Hassan ibn Ali has told me to allow you? He says that I will not be present on the 10th of Muharram. Allow Qasim to be my representative on that day." He goes and he says to him, "You will have permission to go into the battlefield." At this point, Hussein ibn Ali ties the turban upon the head of Qasim. A narration says that he slices it into two, that he wraps one around his chest and then he puts the other around his head. A narration tells us that when he enters into the battlefield, he begins to recite his poetry. He says, "Ana Qasim ibn al-Hasan, sibt an-nabi al-Mustafa wal-mu'tama." I am Qasim, the son of Hassan. He is sibt an-nabi. He is the grandson. He is so close towards the messenger of Allah. I am Qasim. I will not let you rest, for my sword will not allow you to rest. A line of poetry from Qasim says that, "I swear by Allah, as long as I have a sword in my hand, no one will have the ability to touch my uncle Hussein ibn Ali." Qasim enters into the battlefield. We tell a narration that says that he was such a brave warrior at 13 that he did not even wear any armor. He did not even wear a helmet, that he struck the enemies like a brave warrior. People came at him from the left and from the right. But one man by the name of Amr, he comes and he says, "I will strike down this young man." One of the enemies turns and says to him, "Oh Amr, what do you have with this young child? Allow him to fight." But Amr says, "I will attack him and I will ensure that I inflict upon him the greatest grief that he has known." At this point, Qasim is striking the enemies. People are surrounding him by the left and by the right. He is striking each and every one of them down. Amr sneaks up behind him and he pulls that sword back. A narration says that Qasim was such a warrior that when he was fighting, he actually had that his slipper had come apart. He was such a brave warrior that he decided in the middle of the battlefield to come and stop and tie that slipper again so that he did not have to walk upon the burning sands of Karbala. Amr, when he saw Qasim stop to actually put his slipper back on, that's when the tyrant began to strike him. He didn't even have the bravery to strike Qasim from the front. He comes from behind and strikes Qasim on the head. He falls towards the floor and calls out to his father, calls out towards his uncle, "Aghithni ya Amma, come to my aid, oh my uncle. angel, come to assist me in this final moment in time. At this point, Hussein ibn Ali runs in towards the battlefield. He finds that enemy of Allah standing there and engages in the battle with that enemy. He comes and strikes him down. But at that point, horses come to the aid of that enemy. Horses see the lions of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entering into the battlefield. Qasim ibn al-Hassan's body is lying there. I ask you, what would happen to this young 13-year-old's body when horses are going to trample over that body? We say to you, O Qasim, assalamu alayka, peace be upon you, O Qasim. When the other martyrs were trampled by the horses' hooves, they were already dead. They already passed away from this world. Qasim, you were still alive when they trampled upon your body. At that point, Hussein ibn Ali has to stand and watch. He has to see the horses approaching. The horses trample upon the blessed body of Shah Qasim. His body is torn into pieces. His bones are broken as if they are nothing more than powder. They are torn to pieces. As the dust settles, now Hussein ibn Ali begins to see. At this point, he begins to see the broken body of Qasim. Oh Qasim, it hurts your imam. It breaks your imam that you called for him and that he could not come to your aid. Oh Qasim, even if I had come to your aid, there was nothing I could do to assist you at this point in time. One narration says that Qasim's body was broken into so many pieces that Hussein ibn Ali had to open his abba and he had to put the broken pieces of Qasim into that abba. Another narration says that when he picked up the broken body of Qasim, that even though he lifted that body, the legs of Qasim were dragging along the ground. I ask you what the body of Qasim ibn al-Hassan must have looked like. I ask you what Hassan ibn Ali must have been thinking when he was watching this scene. My young son Qasim. Hussein ibn Ali brings that body back towards the tents. At this point already Akbar has passed away. Akbar has already been martyred. Hussein sits between the blessed body of Akbar and he sits between the body of Qasim. He puts one hand on the chest of Qasim. I ask you, Hussein, where would you have found the chest of Qasim? In which pieces? He puts his hand upon the chest of Qasim. He puts his other hand upon the chest of Akbar. Which chest of Akbar? The one that had a spear embedded into it. He looks towards the heavens and he says, O Allah, bear witness what I have taken. O Allah, I want you to never forgive these people. Oh Allah, they have taken the sons of Hussein ibn Ali upon this day. Oh Qasim, no pain shall you fear from now on. No thirst will you take from this moment on. Go with your grandfather Rasulullah. Qasim's body is torn into pieces, but the same could be seen of his brother Abdullah ibn Hassan. When Abu Abdullah is all on his own, as the arrows are embedded into his chest, as the enemies are circling like wolves, as they begin to strike the blessed body of Abu Abdullah, the young son of Hassan Abdullah comes out. Oh enemy man, you will not be allowed to strike my uncle whilst I am still here. He comes in front of him. An enemy begins to strike. He strikes the sword at Abdullah. Abdullah puts his hand in front of the sword in order to defend himself. The arm of Abdullah comes apart and falls towards the floor. He calls out, Oh mother, please, is there anywhere to help me? He falls then into the arms of Abu Abdullah. I ask you, Abdullah, how did the blessed arms of your uncle Hussein feel protecting you at that point in time? But then Hurmala, the same Hurmala that would strike the blessed neck of Asghar, took back an arrow and stood at point blank range. I ask you how close that arrow must have been when he struck it into the chest of Abdullah ibn Hassan. He pulls back that arrow and he lets it go. It flies straight into the abdomen of Abdullah ibn Hassan. He cries out with a shriek of pain, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." Abdullah ibn Hassan is martyred as well. أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ وَسَيَعْلَمُ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا أَيُّ مُنْقَلَبِي أَنْ يَنْقَلِبُونَ إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. مَاتَمِ حُسَيْنَ يَا حُسَيْنَ.